In this lesson, we present some economic problems that are modeled by functional equations. We start with some interest formulas, continue with some taxation formulas, and end with monopoly and duopoly models. I invite the reader to initiate an ice trade with me that consists of generating models based on their properties. We will analyze each of these problems and will try to find some properties to write the corresponding system of functional equations. Once this system is solved, we will see the analytical form of all models satisfying the required conditions. No other models satisfy them. As indicated, we start with some models for the interest formula. Since the cases of the simple and compound interest have been discussed in a previous lesson, we deal next with other models. However, some actual bank policies differ from those previously stated. As a matter of fact, the interest rate is usually dependent on the period and on the amount being deposited. This motivates the search for new interest formulas to be applied in the new situation of the actual economy. Let f of x and t be the total amount received after deposit of an amount x during a period of duration t, and let h of x and t be the accumulated tax rate, as indicated by the formula in the slide. We consider three cases. Case 1. The tax rate corresponding to the sum of two periods of time is given by the product of the tax rates associated with each period, as indicated in Formula 1, which is a Cauchy 2 equation for each x, where we assume that h of x and 0 is equal to 1, and h is continuous and increasing in both arguments. Its general continuous solution is given by expression 2, where p is a non-negative and increasing arbitrary function. We remark that the compound and continuous interest are particular cases with p of x equal to 1 plus x and to e to the x power respectively. The case of interest rate being dependent on the initial investment, whose formula is the one indicated, is included too. We note, however, that the case of simple interest is not included here. Case 2. The accumulated tax rate for an investment x is the accumulated tax rate for a period of duration y raised to a power which is a function of y and x, that is, the one in the formula at the top of the slide, which is a functional equation with general solution as given. Obtaining now f from the h function, we get the solution in the box formula, which clearly generalizes the model obtained in case 1. Case 3. Finally, we can assume that the accumulated tax rate for a period t1 plus t2 can be obtained from the accumulated tax rates for periods t1 and t2, as indicated in the formula of the slide, which is a functional equation with the indicated solution. Note that the h function is any associative function, because this expression was the general solution we obtained when solving the associative functional equation. This finally leads to the general solution of our problem, which is the f function inside the box. Note that this model also generalizes the previous model. A particular case is the one indicated at the bottom of the slide. Note that the product of t by x measures the power of the investment, which includes the amount deposited x and the period of deposit t. Next, we build some taxation models. The first is a simple one, and the second a much more complex model. Let us assume that due taxes depend on the salary and capital incomes x and y respectively. If we want a married couple to pay the same amount independently of whether it is a separate or joint tax return, the indicated functional equation must hold, where we have initially assumed a different tax function for the wife, g, the husband, h, and the case of a couple, f. The solution of this equation is the one indicated. If we add the condition of the same treatment for wife and husband, we get a equal to b. Finally, a zero tax amount for zero income implies a equal to b equal to zero. Next, we present a much more complex taxation model. In this part, we present a taxation model which includes the number of members of the family, the source of the income, salaries or capital, the progressive character of the taxation, etc. Let S be the tax function associated with a family unit with a salary income X obtained after a period of P years and a capital income Y obtained after a period of Q years, assuming it has M tax members, that is M equal to 1 or 2, depending on whether only husband or wife or both receive some income respectively. However, we assume here that M can be a real number in order to allow for children and dependents to be included as non-integer values. The parameters P and Q are used in order to represent irregular income, such as those received after irregular periods of time, that is, more than 1 year. We also assume that the function S is continuous and defined as indicated at the bottom line of the slide. To obtain the tax function, we impose several conditions as follows. First, we impose progressivity of the tax function. In other words, the function S must be increasing with respect to X. It must be increasing with respect to Y. It must be convex with respect to X. It must be convex with respect to Y. And it must be non-increasing with respect to M. Conditions 3 and 4 state that the larger the salary or capital incomes, the larger the tax to be paid. Condition 5 and 6 state that the tax of any additional unit of income must be larger than the tax of previous units. Condition 7 states that the larger the number of tax members in the family unit, the smaller the tax to be paid. Our second condition consists of the independence of the type of tax statement, joint or separate, which is expressed by the functional equations in expressions 8 to 10. Equation 8 expresses the coincidence of the associated tax amounts for identical total income of the family unit. Inequality 9 enforces the joint tax to be smaller or equal than the sum of the individual taxes. Finally, equation 10 enforces the tax coincidence only in the case of equal incomes of all family members. The third condition states the monotonicity of the set income as the two functional inequalities 11 and 12. Inequalities 11 and 12 state that the larger the gross income, the larger the net income, regardless of whether it comes from salary or capital sources. The fourth condition states the independence of the number of tax statements as the functional equations 13, 14, and 15. Equation 13 states that the tax amount must depend only on the total income and not on whether they are declared in 1 or several years. Equation 14 and 15 state that the tax amount must be dependent on the total income, but not on the time of its generation. The fifth condition states the equal treatment for salary and capital incomes in the form of functional equations 16 and 17. Finally, equation 16 makes no distinction between salary and capital incomes, and equation 17 establishes the same tax amounts when the total income is the same, regardless of its source. This theorem provides the general solution to our stated taxation problem, which is the function inside the box. In addition, the arbitrary functions U and V must satisfy the six conditions in the slide to satisfy all the stated conditions, but they are otherwise arbitrary. The physical interpretation of the previous tax function is as follows. Salary and capital income are calculated separately using the gross income per individual and year and the progressive tax functions U and V respectively. This tax function can also be used to encourage an increase in the birth rate because M can be the sum of as many units as tax people in the family plus some fractions to consider son and daughters or dependents. These decisions are not arbitrary, but the consequence of a compatibility imposed by common sense and political conditions. From this, we obtain the following corollary, which shows what happens when salary and capital are equally penalized. If we also impose condition 16 on this task function, we obtain the task function at the bottom of the slide. Our next problem consists of building a monopoly model. Let us assume a firm such that the sales S of a single product depend on the unitary price P and on the advertising expenditures B. The function S cannot be arbitrary. On the contrary, it must satisfy the following properties. Assumption 1. The S function is continuous in both arguments. Assumption 2. For any given V, the S function considered as a function of P only must be convex from below and decreasing. This implies that an increment in the unit price of the product leads to a reduction in sales, but the same advertising expenses, and that its derivative decreases with P. Assumption 3. For any given P, the S function considered as a function of V only must be concave from below and increasing. This implies that an increment in the advertising expenses of the product leads to an increment in sales for the same unit price. We start with model 1. It is reasonable to make the following assumption suggested by Einhorn in 1978. Assumption 4. A multiplicative change in the advertising expenditure leads to an additive change in sales, that is, the functional equation in 19 holds. The general continuous solution of equation 19 can be obtained as follows. Noting that for any p, it is a Pexider functional equation, we get the functions in 20. Our model 2 uses assumption 5. The sales due to an increment pi in price are equal to the previous sales times a real number, which depends on pi and v, that is, the functional equation 21 holds. The general solution of the functional equation 21 can be obtained as follows. Making p equal to 0 in 21, we get the expressions 22, where the capital E function is arbitrary. Substitution of 22 into 21 leads to functional equation 23, which for each fixed v is a Cauchy functional equation 2, with general solution as in 24 an arbitrary D function. Thus, the general solution of 21 is the one in 25. Once we have solved functional equations 19 and 21 separately, our model 3 combines assumption 4 and 5, that is, solves the system 19 and 21 by forcing both general solutions to be identical, that is, functional equation 26 to hold. Thus, the general continuous solution of the model defined by assumption 4 and 5 is, as given by Einhorn in 1978, page 15, the S function in expression 27, where A, B, and C are arbitrary constants. Note that in model 27 we have no arbitrary functions anymore, but arbitrary constants. This means that the parametric model is completely specified and that we can estimate its parameters A, B, and C using empirical data. Model 27 shows a logarithmic increment of sales with advertising expenditures and an exponential decrease with price, in agreement with assumptions 4 and 5. One justification of this model of sales is the so-called Weber-Fechner law, that states that the stimuli of the intensity of perception is a linear function of the logarithm of the intensity of the stimulus. Unfortunately, the resulting R function is independent of B, contrary to what was apparently suggested by equation 21. The interpretation of this fact is that equation 19 together with 21 implies this independence. In other words, no function R depending on the two arguments pi and v satisfied both 19 and 21. Our model 4 is based on the previous result. It can be argued that the function R should depend on the price p instead of b. Thus, we can replace assumption 5 by assumption 5a, that the sales due to an increment pi in price are equal to the previous sales times a real number, which depends on pi and p, that is, the functional equation 28, where the conditions indicated at the bottom of the slide must be satisfied. The general solution of 28 can be obtained as follows. Making p equal to 0 in 28, we get the expression at the top of the slide. Next, back substitution into 28 leads to the R function indicated. Thus, the general solution of 28 is 29, where C and D are arbitrary functions. Alternatively, we can assume in our model 5 a multiplicative instead of an additive change in the price P, and we can question whether or not choosing between one of these assumptions influences the resulting model. We shall see that they are equivalent. Assumption 5b. The sale is due to a multiplicative change, lambda times, in the price are equal to the previous sales times a real number, which depends on lambda and p, that is equation 30, where the conditions below must be satisfied. Similarly, making p equal to 1 in 30, we get the relations at the top of the slide, and back substitution into 30 leads to the following expression, which implies the given R function. Consequently, the general solution of 30 is 31, where C and D are arbitrary functions. Know that the S function in 29 and 31 are identical. Thus, equation 28 and 30 are equivalent. Consequently, the above mentioned two assumptions 5a and 5b lead to the same model. Our model 6 is motivated by this result. We can ask whether or not using an additive instead of a multiplicative change in the advertising expenditures in equation 19 influences the resulting model. Surprisingly, condition 19 is not equivalent to 32, which for any p is a Pfeffer's type 1 equation with general solution in 33. Know that this is different from the previous solution 20, which was based on assumption 4. Our model 7 includes assumption 1 and 4. The solution of the system 19 and 28 can be obtained by solving the functional equation 34, which forces both solutions in 20 and 29 to be compatible. Equation 34 is a sum of products equation. Thus, using the well-known theorem that gives its general solution, we can write the three equations at the bottom of the slide. Then, the general solution of 34 is the one at the top, which leads to the model 35, where the A function and the constant B are arbitrary. For 35 to satisfy assumptions 2 and 3 above, the A function must be convex from below and decreasing. Note that log B plus B is increasing. Note that model 35 is more general than model 27 and that now, contrary to Eichhorn's model, R depends on both arguments, pi and p, as initially. Finally, we deal with several duopoly models. Assume now that we have two different firms that compete in the market. Assume also that the sales S of the products by firm 1 depend on the unit prices P and Q and on the advertising expenditures B and W of the two firms. Next, we present several models with the following assumptions. The function S must satisfy the following properties. Assumption 1. The S function must be continuous in all its arguments. Assumption 2. Function S must be increasing in Q and V. Assumption 3. The S function must be decreasing in P and W. In our model 1, we make assumption 4. A multiplicative change in the advertising expenditure of firms 1 leads to an additive change in sales, that is, functional equation 36 holds. In our model 1, we also make assumption 5a. The sales due to an increment pi in price of firm 1 are equal to the previous sales times a real number, which depends on pi and p, that is, functional equation 37, where obviously, when the increment of price pi is null, we have the same sales. The general solution of the system 36 and 37 is given in 38, where the a and b functions are arbitrary. In our model 2, we make assumption 6. The total sales of both firms is a constant, k. Equation 38 and 39 gives equation 40. Since for fixed P and Q, equation 40 is a sum of products equation, we can write expression 41 and 42, where 43 must hold, which implies 44 and then 45 to 48. In this slide, we perform some operations to obtain the relations between the B and C functions and 52. In this slide, we impose some compatibility conditions derived from 47, 48, and 52 to obtain the B function. This slide explains how to proceed to reach the final result in the next slide. Only the interested reader should study this in detail, because it is not necessary to understand what follows. After this involved derivation, we obtain the lowercase b function in 65, and finally, the general solution of our model is 66. Where alpha is an increasing arbitrary function. The physical interpretation of model 66 is as follows. If the advertisement expenditures for both firms are coincident, the sales are proportional to the indicated ratios for firms 1 and 2 respectively. The advertisement expenditures influence sales directly proportional to the logarithm of the ratio V over W, and inversely proportional to alpha of P plus alpha of Q. Our model 3 uses assumption 7. The sales S of firm 1 due to increments alpha and beta in the prices of firms 1 and 2 respectively are the initial sales S of firm 1 times two factors which consider the associated reduction and increments due to these two changes. That is, the functional equation 67 holds. Making P equal to Q equal to 0, we get 68, which implies 69. Replacing 69 in 67, we get 70. And making beta equal to 0, we obtain 71, which leads to 72, where E is an arbitrary function. Similarly, making alpha equal to 0 in 70, we obtain 73, where the E function must satisfy for 74. Finally, the general solution is the one shown at the bottom of the slide. Our model 4 uses assumption 8. The sales S of firm 1 due to increments alpha and beta in the advertisement expenditures of firms 1 and 2 respectively are the initial sales S of firm 1 times two factors which consider the associated increments and decrements due to these two changes. That is, functional equation 75 holds. The solution of this functional equation is the one given in 76 at the bottom of the slide. Our model 5 combines assumption 7 and 8. That is, we get the system of equation in 77, which leads to the model in 78, where the functions A and G are decreasing and the function B and F are increasing, but otherwise arbitrary. The physical interpretation of this model is as follows. All the factors, prices and advertising expenditures act independently and contribute to the total sales of firm 1 as a factor which is less than 1 and decreasing for P and W, and greater than 1 and increasing for Q and V. In this lesson, we have given interesting problems in economy that can be solved with functional equations. We have seen some interest formulas arising from some properties that characterize them, showing that they are the only ones satisfying those properties. We have also derived some taxation functions and some models to reproduce a duopoly market. You should be convinced at this time about the possibilities that functional equations offer to this important field. I invite you to follow the next lesson dedicated to application to statistics, in which we provide very interesting and surprising problems that are easily solved in the statistical area with the help of functional equations.